Come on, shake your body, baby, do the conga. I know you can't control yourself any longer. Feel the rhythm of the music as it's getting stronger. Don't fight it till you try to do the conga beat.
I think Ben can't control himself any longer. You're so excited.
We're doing it today. Do the conga, Diane. I don't know. Do the conga.
Is it like one of these things?
I don't know how to do it either. You just let the rhythm move your feet. It's all there in the lyrics. You don't have to worry about
you. It's going to get you.
The rhythm is going to get you. Yeah. We're discussing Gloria Estefan and the Miami Sound Machine today.
Yes, we are.
But I guess we're also going to be discussing my love of Latin beats and Latin hips. This one might get a little weird. I apologize.
I might just sit back and watch you guys for this one.
this is a Patreon episode. It was not meant to be a guest episode, but from our Patreon, we pulled the great Greg Warren, and Greg chose Gloria Estefan and the Miami Sound Machine to do. And Greg has graciously offered to join us again. Greg Warren is here. G-Rock, Greggy Greg, how are you?
Hey, what's up, guys? How's it going?
Good to see you. You are our first repeat guest.
Really? It's a lot of pressure.
It's an honor.
it's a huge honor. You guys, I think you drew my name out like the day after I went and saw the musical Get On Your Feet, which is it's the Gloria Estefan story.
Yeah.
And I was like, I loved it, man. I don't go to musicals. I've recently was like, I need to get a little more culture. It's gotta be good for me. So there's this really awesome like outdoor opera thing in St. Louis. And I was like, I got these tickets because I was like, oh, I'll take my niece, you know, she didn't want to go. So my buddy Chris went with me. Both of us like, I mean, I swear I cried during this thing. I laughed. The jokes were pretty good. The acting was great. And you guys know how I'm like terrible with music.
Seven Grammys. I don't think the world would agree with this one.
No, I just like, I don't know anything about it. And it's like everything else. I heard it all during my, you know, formative years in the 80s. She was all over the radio and I just didn't notice anything. Like, I don't notice hardly anything else in life. And then I'm like, yeah, man, I like Gloria Estefan, I think, you know, and then they do this musical and I'm like, I love her. I love the, yeah. You know, like I kept going to my buddy, like this, how are they going to finish this musical? She didn't have any more hits. He's like, she's got 9 more hits. She's got like, she's got plenty of hits, man. They ran out of songs, you know? Go see Get On Your Feet if you can.
I haven't seen it, but I've researched her story and it's incredible. Like,
yeah, man.
An incredible stage show, an incredible movie. Like I thought, like obviously, if you know anything about Gloria Estefan and the Miami Sound Machine, you know that they're Cubans from Miami. That's really all I knew about Gloria Estefan,
right?
And that she had that great song "Conga" that had a real effect on me as an 8 or 9 year old boy. Sorry, I don't mean to be too saucy, but that was my intro to Gloria Estefan. I was like,
"Oh yeah, man!" Houston, yeah,
the first women that I remember looking at, going, "Why do I feel this way? What is this feeling?"
All right, Ben. So I have to ask you, because you were telling me before we recorded that, like, it was Whitney Houston and Gloria Estefan, and then you started having these feelings. They would play those videos around the same time. And I'm like, did it affect you for the rest of your life having a weird thing for women with big perms?
That's why his parents actually had to move him from Canada to Texas.
Come to the hair, like we go big.
He got on a Greyhound bus out of Edmonton one time and just wound up in Texas, and his parents, you know, found him and they just stayed there.
God, that's horrible. It really could well be that. My parents are English and Irish. They may very well have looked at me and just go, we're going to have to move someplace where our son's somewhat colonial sexual ambitions.
And it worked, Ben.
Yeah, man. I mean, there's so much about her. And then I just did this deep dive on her for like 2 weeks after that musical, learn all this stuff. The one of the there's a million things about that musical. What they, she said that she married Emilio, the guy that founded Miami Sound Boys. I think they're Miami something boys or my, the
Miami Latin boys.
Boys. Yeah. Yeah. And then they became Miami Sound Machine. Then they became Gloria Estefan and the Miami Sound Machine, but she married Emilio and they went to like the producers, like, we want to do this. We want to do this musical, you know, and we want to do this, My Life Story or Our Life Story. And everybody, whoever said, well, it's great, but there's just no conflict in your guys' life. Like, you guys met when you were young and she, I don't think ever dated anybody but him.
Her first boyfriend.
Yeah. And you have this great marriage. And she said, I saw this clip where she was like, okay, well, let me introduce you to my mother. And they're like,
yeah.
That's great.
Yeah.
That is a crazy thing. Now that I know a bit about Gloria Estefan's life, to look at her and just go, yeah, I don't see any conflict here. You're like, her whole life has been a conflict.
Yeah. Yeah. Just not romantic. Died. Not romantic conflict between the two. But yeah, man.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know. Do you want to do the lyrics first and then get into the life of Gloria Estefan?
Well, tell us before we start, why did you, out of all of her songs, why did you pick Words Get in the Way?
Well, here's the thing is, because, you know, I'm a fan of the podcast and I like hearing you guys break down the lyrics. And I mean, her lyrics are so like inspired from her life and so true. And a lot of times there's like nothing behind, there's nothing hidden behind the lyrics because she's just so open. And then, you know, of the hits, it's like, you're probably not going to, I was like, as much as I love the song, I'm like, I don't know if Ben's going to want to analyze the lyrics to Conga.
Yeah, I was like, please, I'm not going to see Conga.
Or Get on Your Feet. But most of her, I mean, I don't mean to say they're simplistic because they're beautiful. And I think they work and they come from the heart. But I was like, okay, that's one of those songs that like, I maybe knew. It's one of those songs on some level. I was like, I love this song and I've always loved that song. But I don't even know if I realized that she sang it until I went and saw the musical.
Just,
I don't pay enough attention. And I was, and of all of her songs, I mean, there's some other ones probably, but of all her songs, I was like, maybe there's some complexities that Ben can do a deep dive in.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, like Rhythm Is Gonna Get You, little known fact. Rhythm was the name of a very popular Miami hitman.
And is that right? Is that true? Rhythm was. Is that right, man?
Can't be true.
Man, nobody knows that, and I did. I did a deep dive on her. Nobody. That's amazing that you found that out.
He's the Cuban boogeyman. We just didn't know.
Which was only Rhythm.
Evil. Let's do the lyrics.
Let's do it.
Words Get in the Way by Gloria Estefan and the Miami Sound Machine. And Miami Sound Machine, excuse me.
I realize you're seeing someone new. I don't believe she knows you like I do.
I realize you're seeing someone new. I don't believe she knows you like I do. That's my favorite. Like, they don't love you like I love you.
There's so many songs like this. Like, George Strait kind of has like the opposite of, but you know me better than that. He's like, you know, he's talking to his ex where she's like, she tells my friends I'm perfect and I love her cat. And he's like, and you've seen the me that gets lazy and fat. And he's like, you know me better than that.
The private me. That's the real thing. This, I read it before we get too far into it, because I think she's pretty explicit about what the song is about. She wrote this song after she and Emilio had a fight, which makes a lot of sense. We'll get into their relationship, but he's not like tyrannical. Like, it's not like an Ike and Tina sort of thing.
Right.
But he is like a really hard driving, let's make a lot of money about his business kind of guy.
Competitive.
Yeah, you don't get, it's the old Bill Clinton saying, like, if you see a tortoise on top of a fence post, it didn't get there by accident. Like, if you see a Cuban American girl on top of the pop charts, didn't happen by accident.
Yeah, man. They fought that hard.
Yeah.
Just a quick little story, and it was in the musical, but you know, I've done a bunch of radio and stuff. And one of the stations that I've done, there's this guy named Guy Phillips, and he was on a station called Y98 with my friend Courtney, who actually I'm wearing their shirt. Well, right
now. You are.
The Courtney radio show. I didn't plan this, but so they were together for a long time. And I guess, so she could not get it played on the American pop charts. Conga, they thought Conga was going to be a hit, and they just couldn't get anybody to play it. And their own record label is like, we're making a ton of money off of you guys in South America. Like, just shut up. We're giving you a bag full of money. Like, shut up. You're not going to be, they don't play Latino music on the white radio. And I guess somebody was like, hey, I know some people. They said, like, in the musical, they were like, hey, we can't get it played in New York and LA. And someone's like, well, what if we try in the middle? And this friend of mine, Guy Phillips, was at Y98, was like one of the first people to play Gloria Estefan on the radio. And I think it was Conga, and they mentioned it. Now, it was in St. Louis, but I'd like to think that they sort of mention it anyways, because I'd heard this story before. So in the musical, they're like, I know a guy, his name's Guy Phillips. It was really cool.
I know a guy.
And I'm really such an idiot. I was like, I wish they would have like come out and said Guy's name more. And my friend Chris is like, they said, I know a guy. Like, oh.
Now it lands on
me.
Really? That's cool. That's a cool connection that you didn't even realize was a connection when you chose the song.
Yeah, it's pretty awesome.
Well, maybe you did.
I knew, but I just learned. Yeah.
Okay.
The next line, your temperamental moody side, the one you always try to hide from me. That kind of made me bust out laughing, because I'm sure my girlfriend would just be like, yeah, your temperamental moody side, the one that I wish you would try harder to hide from me.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah,
why
yeah,
does
man.
That guy have to crop up every midnight? What the fuck?
I think maybe there's something in that where every guy is like, see, now this girl actually, she sort of appreciates it. I do get moody, and she understands. Right? It is, I think that's a perfect lyric, though, man. I really think that couplet is perfect, man. Mm.
But I know when you have something on your mind, you've been trying to tell me for the longest time. And before you break my heart in two, there's something I've been trying to say to you. I don't want like Gloria Estefan is fluently bilingual, but like, I wonder, like, the very, very little Spanish that I know, it seems like every single word rhymes. I wonder if people who start off speaking Spanish feel the same way about English, because obviously like rhyming two and you is the sort of thing that an English lyricist would be like, hey, it's kind of too easy. But in this case, like, well, it's so easy that it's the only way you could possibly say it.
Yeah.
Before
you break my heart in two is that lyric has always gotten me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because it's kind of funny how your heart always just like cleaves in half. You know, you only notice it's broken evenly in two. You know, there's percentages. Like, she broke off 12.5% of my heart.
That's always 50%. Right down the middle.
The 51% rule. No one's writing a poem unless it's 51%.
Yeah, exactly. No fractions here.
Yeah.
Less than a half fraction.
Yeah. And before you break my heart in thirds, just didn't.
He's like, wait, what?
Well, words. I don't know.
Thirds and words. Too. Just go with it, Emilio. Yeah.
But the words get in the way. There's so much I want to say.
It's hard not to sing it, but the words get in the way. There's so much I want to say, but it's locked deep inside. And if you look in my eyes, we might fall in love again. Yeah.
That fear.
I don't want to see her again. Not because I'm still mad at her, not because, but just because I'm worried, like, oh, fuck, what if it starts all over again?
Yeah. I'm going to interject here. Have you guys seen, apparently it was a book, and now it's like a show, a series on HBO. It's called Scenes from a Marriage.
Yeah. Oh, was that the Adam Driver and
Oscar
Isaac and Jessica Chastain.
I saw it. I was in a hotel in Florida after like a 12-hour road trip, and I had to get up the next morning to do a show. This was a couple of nights ago, and I just was like, I gotta just watch a little TV to see if I can fall asleep. And I flipped it on, and it was like haunting.
It's rough.
It was brutal, but it was. I mean, they're both really good actors. So
Oscar Isaac is amazing. Like, is there anything he can't do? I'm asking because I need the sheetrock in my bathroom repair.
Diane didn't know she had a thing for Oscar Isaac until the show. I don't think I like Llewellyn, whatever the other shows he's in, I don't think I saw. So the second episode I just watched, and it's completely different than the first episode. Like, it gets harder. And this song, it's good timing because it's like, you know, trying to save a marriage when, you know, you think someone's leaving and you're like trying to do anything you can to keep them. And sometimes the other person is like realizing like they're gone, like this isn't going to happen. And how like,
oh yeah,
crushing.
Oh, brutal, man. Brutal. She just floors him with, I watched that thing and it's just two people. I don't know if there's anybody else for like 30 minutes on the screen. I was like, oh my God, this is,
it's
this
too is lifelike. So I told Corbin, he won't watch it with me. He likes comedies. He's not doing this with me. And I was like, it became a horror movie. Like, I think they film nonstop for 20 straight minutes. The director said just this intense scene of like, just, she's breaking his heart. It's so horrible.
Yeah.
Oh, but I can't stop watching it. But I was also like, I will dive into that bed and bump her redheaded ass onto the hard floor and be like, Oscar, I will never do this to you. I love you. And I'd never seen him because his character is like a Jewish guy, but he's not. He's like Guatemalan. And I was looking at pictures of him without the beard and everything. I was like, oh my God, he's hot. And then I was like, oh, you know what he looks like? He looks like Corbin. He's got the big, thick, bushy eyebrows and the big eyeballs. I was like, all right, I got a type.
Yeah, you got a type. That's good. Yeah.
All right, enough about Oscar Isaac because I will spiral. keep going.
I won't even start to cry before I say goodbye. I tried to say I love you, but the words got in the way, which is true. I mean, it's the simple truth. Like, it does. Like, how many times have you been sitting in front of somebody that you're just like all I want to say is I love you. But either those words don't come out or they're just not sufficient for the problem at hand.
Not enough.
Yeah. Like, how many times, like, especially in your primary relationships where you're just like, well, words are kind of useless.
Yeah.
Like, it's the thing. Like, it doesn't matter what you say, it matters what you do. And there are so many times with your significant other where you're just like, I mean, we can have the conversation, but really what we need to have is a better tomorrow.
Yeah.
Like, that's,
we need to go to bed.
Yeah.
Or Extreme is going to come through the door singing More Than Words. I mean, I want to hear these songs back to back now. Mm.
That's kind of a weirdly complex song when you think about it in those terms. Like, when I was a kid, I remember thinking of like More Than Words by Extreme as being like the cruelest come on. You know, where you're just like doing like this very, very sweet, like, come on, baby, you know what I want. But then as you get older and you realize that relationships go on much longer than one night of passion, you realize like, I guess he's probably not just talking about sex.
Yeah, exactly.
It's definitely, I'm going to need you to get up at 8 a.m. and face the day. Hey, your heart has always been an open door, but baby, I don't even know you anymore. Ouch.
Yeah, man.
Ouch.
Was there anything, was she just being poetic with these lyrics? Like, let's pretend a situation where someone is seeing someone new, or did Emilio ever cheat on her? Did she ever say?
Yeah, I mean, that's what I was wondering about this, because one of you guys said that they had a, obviously they've been married forever and together forever, but I always thought the relationship was rock solid.
Good. Like,
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the impression that I got. Like, in all the research that I did, there didn't seem to be any, like, he's cheating on her scandals. This song, obviously, you know, tends to hint at it, and it's entirely possible that their relationship is, or they're just so dependent on each other. I mean, they have an empire. Like the Miami Sound Machine, like it sounds like, oh, it's this great 18-piece band. It's not. It's Emilio and Gloria Estefan and then hired hands.
What's his name? John Secada was, I think, part of the Miami Sound Machine.
That's right.
Yeah. Yeah, who had a couple of his own hits there at one time.
He had a huge big hit.
Yeah.
It's amazing. I was working at a bar where they had like a super popular DJ and they opened their set with John Secada's Just Another Day. And what the fuck do I know what kids are listening to? But like, my head just went, oh my God, there's no way this is, but it did. Like, it really set off the dance floor. Like,
nice.
Absolutely loved it. I was like, I haven't even heard this song since 1992.
Yeah.
And holy crap. Yeah. It still slaps.
Well, so right before we started this, I was watching the end of an interview with her and she was talking about like, Emilio, they worked with a lot of other artists and she's like, man, you got to have like, you got to trust your marriage when he's in the studio till 5 a.m. with Shakira and J-Lo and Madonna. And you're like, oh, so apparently she was like, all right, you good? We good? All right, go.
Yikes. That Shakira. Would be because like what's the power? Because like J-Lo is probably bigger than Gloria Estefan now.
Yeah.
But J-Lo in the mid-90s, obviously the power struggle, but then can you imagine like Gloria Estefan and Madonna's in studio power struggles?
Yeah. Because Madonna probably had, I mean, J-Lo, I know she had a music career, but she didn't have as many hits as Gloria Estefan.
No.
I
mean,
yeah.
Madonna did though.
Yeah.
For sure. Yeah. And I think J-Lo no doubt sells more gossip magazines than Gloria Estefan would these days.
Yeah.
Man, I'd buy that Estefan. I've been trying to find everything out there on her. Man, I'd buy the gossip magazine on Gloria. Yeah,
I think Estefan and Jennifer Lopez would just like get in a fight over who spends more time in the gym. I think it would just be like serious gym rat lady competitions. I just see the two of them like locking eyes and holding a plank for 47 days.
And you just being like, I'm here for all 47.
Yep.
I hope none of you break.
Evil. And that goes into the chorus again. But the words get in the way. There's so much I want to say, but it's locked deep inside. And if you look in my eyes, I might fall in love again. I won't even start to cry. And before I say goodbye, I tried to say I love you, but the words got in the way. No, it's the perfect ballad.
Yeah, it is. I think during the in the musical, I don't know this for sure, but I think maybe they were talking about her not talking to her mom when they played this song. Oh. Because that was it. Like, oh. I guess when she wanted to take her sister on the road with her younger sister on the road with Emilio and them, and her mother kind of forbade it, and then she did anyways. And the mom didn't talk to her for like a year, two Whoa. Years. And then the mom was watching TV and sees scrolling on the bottom, Gloria Estefan killed in bus accident.
Oh, whoa.
In upstate New York or Pennsylvania or something like that. And then, you know, finds out she wasn't obviously killed. But it was it was a terrible accident where she, like it was awful. And she had to sort of rebuild herself over a year, but I think that they were using this. I can't remember, but I think they might have been using this song to be like, hey, you know, there was a breakdown of communication between.
Wow, are they okay now? Was the car accident or the bus accident what brought them like?
Yeah.
I did watch. So after the bus accident, you know, this girl's competitive. The doctor was like, oh, you'll probably never, you may walk again if you work hard, but you may never get back on stage again. And 10 months later, she was at the American Music Awards and she came out and performed Coming Out of the Dark or whatever that song is. And standing ovation. I cried. I went back and watched it. I was oh my God.
Yeah.
She did both things during her rehabilitation. Like she had her back was broken. Like they installed 2 8-inch metal rods in her back.
Yeah.
And like Gloria Estefan is only so many multiples of 8 inches tall. Like she is
right.
Was a lot of her tiny little body is metal now. Like, but she did both things. Like to think that you can come back from a broken back to be able to perform like that in 10 months is one thing, but then to also, like I watched a documentary that showed her, I think it was called Coming Out of the Dark, and it showed her just putting that song together. and all the work that goes into all the choices that get made. You know, like she's got to push herself in the studio, then push herself in rehab, and then push herself on stage and in rehearsals in order to come back there. Like, it's no small feat. It's not a medical miracle. Like, it's a straight up, I'm getting up every goddamn morning and I am working my way back. Like, it's a crazy amount of grit you have to do what she did.
And I bailed after 20 minutes of trying to write jokes this morning. Yeah.
I was waiting for you to stop talking so I can be like, one time I had surgery on my pinky toe. Yeah. I had
no surgeries. I had no surgeries. And this morning I woke up and I was like, I need to get back to it, you know? And I wrote for like 20 minutes and I was like, no, I can't do it.
Well, Greg, you know what? I know you've heard us talk about you on this podcast. Your work ethic with comedy is so good. I think you've reached a level now where if you need to take a break after 20 minutes, you can take that break.
Yeah, I don't know. I've gotten that reputation with you guys, and I'll just take it. But you'll take it. I mean, yeah. I mean, it could be several things. One. I'm old. So like I've put out a bunch of material because I've been around for a long time. Or two, like the bar is just not that high with comedians. It's just not, I mean, I'm talking to people like, oh man, you work so hard. I'm like, I don't, I had a job where you had to be in the office all day. Like, I mean, it's like, if you write a new 20 minutes every year, people like, you know, you're outworking. You know, yeah. Now, and I know the guys that work way harder than me and are also more successful. So, but, yeah, I'll take it. Yeah.
Yeah.
But this morning I really did it. I was just like, I was sitting there at the coffee shop and I was like, I don't know what it is. You know, I'm just, yeah. It was garbage.
Yeah. I just think I don't have the, you know, not that I like to milk things, but I just don't have the competitiveness or the insane drive people who make it have, you know what I mean? Like, she was like, I will be on stage again. I will jump. I will do all of these things again.
And he was part of that too. I think like they show him pushing her.
He's like,
oh, it's incredible. Yeah. Like their inside joke has apparently lasted their whole marriage. Like they got together. He was, let's go back and kind of tell the story of their families and sort of where they come.
Yeah. I'll be right back, guys. I'll keep going, but I'll be right back.
Yeah, of course. So Emilio's family, Emilio Estefan's family, they owned in Santiago de Cuba, they owned an underwear factory, a garment factory. And then when the Cuban Revolution came along, it was seized by Fidel and the communists. And Emilio and his family first fled to Spain, and from there they got temporary visas into America. So he spent 2 years in Spain and then moved to Miami. What? When he got to Miami, like, it's a hardcore Cuban immigrant. Like, he's living in a small apartment with 15 relatives, and it's just like, get out there and make some money. Like, this is America. You get out there and you figure it out.
Yeah.
So he starts, you know, doing those kinds of things. Street hustling is where he begins. He ends up getting a job in the mailroom of Bacardi, the big rum company.
Ooh.
And he slowly works his way up from there. Bacardi is a huge, it's not just a major brand, it's a huge big company worldwide. And within a dozen years, Emilio ends up being like their marketing director for all the Hispanic market in America. So it's a very, very high level position that he finds himself in. And now he's making like $100,000 a year. So he starts using that money to sort of fund his hobbies. He goes and buys an accordion at some point along the way, and goes to an Italian restaurant and says, I'm going to play like proper Cuban rhythms on the accordion just for tips. Like, you don't have to pay me anything. Like, the restaurant owner's like, fine, okay, go ahead and do it. His boss at Bacardi finds out that he's doing this, and he starts hiring Emilio to come and work private parties. So he's getting paid a little bit of money to go do these things. So that's when he starts finding musicians. He finds bass players and keyboardists, and they come together and they form the Miami Latin Boys, which is the beginning of Miami Sound Machine. He's working at a wedding, with Gloria, I can't pronounce it, Fajardo.
Yeah. If I were just going to be a white suburban lady, I'd be like Fajardo, but yeah,
Fajardo.
Fajardo. I don't know.
Fajardo is probably closer to it. Should have asked Natalie to teach me how to pronounce that one. Fajardo.
Come on, Ben.
I know, I really let it down. So there, there's a wedding, and they've hired the Miami Latin boys to come in. So her and her sister Mercy perform at that wedding, just doing like Cuban standard songs, and Emilio falls in love with her warm voice. And that's when they sort of kick off. Like, he immediately asks them to join the band because he's a marketing genius. Like, he sees he's in competition with all of these other Cuban party bands for weddings and quinceañeras and all those sorts of things. And he realizes that if he has two female lead singers, it's an unbelievable step up over all of these other bands. Because when you're booking weddings and quinceañeras, you're talking to the tías, you're talking to the mamas, you're talking, you know, it's the women are doing the party organizing. So it's just like, I've got these two women up front. He corners the market on Miami parties. Like, the Miami sound machine becomes like the go-to. They're working every weekend. They're getting paid all sorts of money. And it's not long after that he's able to quit his job with Bacardi and focus on Gloria Estefan full time. But the whole reason, like, their joke, apparently, like one of the first nights that they were together, he listens to Gloria sing, he loves her. He sits her down, he tells her just like, you're fantastic, but I think you can be 95% better. And he sticks to that for years. Like, that's the inside joke. Like, no matter how hard she works, no matter how far they get, no matter how many records they sell in Latin America, his only note to her is always, you can be 95%.
Yeah, better. And he never took it down to 86 or something like that?
Nope. Number never got any lower.
That's really funny.
Wow.
It's an insane thing to think of.
The other thing I heard, there's two things also that I remember hearing. One, her mother at some point won a contest to be Shirley Temple's double in Hollywood, but she was going to her parents were going to have to sign over ownership of the daughter or something. And the father at some point was like, no. So her mom sort of was all in on show business, but kind of resented that. I think she didn't get to accomplish her dream.
Oh, and then the other thing is,
I don't think it was Shirley Temple. I think it was a little later than that. I think it was like Liza Minnelli or somebody like that. But she was
I read Shirley Temple. Yeah. Okay.
All right. But yeah, I heard she was hired to do like the Spanish overdubbing. Like, as they were going to sell the movies in Latin America, she was hired to be the voiceover for that, which obviously would have been huge, big money. I don't know what grandpa was thinking there.
Yeah.
Nice work.
Some of it sounded a little weird. It was like, you know, it's back then in the studio days. It was like the studio was going to own her or something like that. Like, they had to basically say, this isn't your kid anymore. And I think the guy was like, yeah, you know, no, I think I'm going to say no. And then
I saw what you did to Rita Hayworth.
Yeah. I think when she met Emilio, she was like, she had a job at some point with the customs office where she was translating they wanted her to join the CIA.
Yeah.
Was it the CIA or the FBI or something like that?
Yeah. She was approached by the CIA as a possible employee because, you know, she could do the English, Spanish, French translation.
Her family story is crazy. Like how closely she's tied to the Cuban Revolution and all of the troubles.
Bay of Pigs. Like, her dad was in Bay of Pigs, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Her dad was basically like he was a cop, but he was basically like a palace guard for Batista, right?
Yeah.
So he's literally like the motorcycle cop who's riding in the motorcade with Batista. So when Batista gets overthrown, he's in the first wave of Cubans to get off the island and get into Miami. Well, as soon as he gets there, like, that's exactly who the CIA is looking for. They're looking for the Cuban ex-military guys. They're looking for the Cuban ex-police, the guys who have the ties, who know how the island runs, know where the levers of power are. So he immediately gets recruited for the Bay of Pigs. And you know, he's like Cuban operative who goes back. Obviously, the Bay of Pigs is a huge, big disaster. Here, her father gets captured by his own cousin. Like, own that's cousin. How. Like.
Whoa, I missed that, man. Wow.
His own cousin was working for Castro.
Yeah, when your country goes through a revolution, it divides families, as we learned in the Civil War, and we're gonna learn again.
Shit.
It's so true, man. Yeah.
So he got captured by his own cousin. He was held in a Cuban prison for 18 months. After the Bay of Pigs, and I think even after the Cuban Missile Crisis, he gets released in a deal that the Kennedy government has made, like, you know, prisoner release, you know, that kind of transfer. Her dad is finally able to come to Miami and you know, be a proper American. He immediately joins the army and gets sent to, he volunteers for Vietnam, where he's exposed to Agent Orange. And from the Agent Orange, he comes back. Like, his thinking was like, I'm going to join the American military. I'll rise up through the ranks with all of these other Cubans. And once we've gone and performed our duty in Vietnam or wherever they send us, then we can start lobbying the American government to go and overthrow Castro again, to try something akin to the Bay of Pigs one more time. That was his goal. You know, he was very much a free Cuba again, kind of, you know, lifelong, you know, fighting for the island sort of type. But after that, he was diagnosed with multiple sclerosis after coming back from Vietnam, and that ended his fighting days. So that's how she became a possible CIA asset. It's like the opposite of like Taylor Swift's story, you know, where like Taylor Swift's dad is a huge big Wall Street executive who basically bought her studio time and built her up, which sure, you do the best for your daughter, but like she was coming into a different family business.
Yeah, very different.
Like you're not going to be singing. What a lot of people
don't know is Taylor Swift is in the CIA actually.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of people don't know about Taylor Swift. Real good at killing communists. Really good. Poison cigarettes, throat slitting. She's good with a piano wire.
Yeah, man.
One day, I don't know how it'll fit into this podcast, but I'm sure Corbin's just dying to tell his Mo Berg story, that baseball player that worked for the undercover for the United States government. Corbin loves the story because he has his baseball card, and it's a really true story. Yeah, and they were making a movie about it, and Paul Rudd was going to play him. I don't know if it actually came to fruition, but I never saw it. But yeah, we'll tell that story another time. But
who's the baseball player?
Mo Berg.
Okay,
have to look it up.
I know what I'm doing this afternoon.
Not cool writing story. 20 more minutes of comedy. That's what you're not doing.
Yep.
I want to stress that 20 minutes that I was that there was no comedy written.
I was amazed at how deeply embedded Gloria Estefan and her family are in Cuban history, because like obviously I knew that she was Cuban, but I figured that she was Cuban in the same way that I'm Irish, you know, like okay, like I like there's some family stories that are tied to the politics and, yeah, a car got stolen and somebody set it on fire and
right,
you know, I wasn't expecting just like oh no, you were both recruited into the CIA, your dad was in the Bay of Pigs, your grandfather was Batista's personal chef. Like,
yeah,
there's just so many things that are just like holy living crap. Like it's amazing how closely tied she is to the Cuban drama.
Her life is insane. I mean, just that alone is an interesting story. And then she comes a pop star. She won 7 Grammys. She gets in a near fatal accident and comes back. She gets the Presidential Medal of Freedom from Obama. I mean,
her and Emilio got it, I believe.
Yeah, they got it together. I'm like, okay, Forrest Gump, calm down. Like, this is a lot of like life happening to you.
Man, I've heard some tall tales in my day, but this
met the president again. Because when she got in that bus accident, she was leaving a meeting with George H. Bush or George W. Bush, George H. Bush, who was president? Had been George
H. W. The first one, yeah.
President one, and then yeah, I met the president again. I mean, like Jesus, Gloria.
Man, I watched Forrest Gump again the other night again in some hotel room, and it was about an hour of it, and I was reminded that Ben always had very derogatory things to say about Robin Wright Penn's character in that movie, and I remember Ben's ex-girlfriend Amanda, she took up for Robin Wright Penn's character. Ben, very, very, very awful things to say about her.
The whole internet has caught up to your way of thinking, Ben. No one likes Penny anymore.
Well, Ben was first on that, I'm telling you, man. Yeah, he's just very, very terrible things to say about her. I just remember Amanda being like, you stop! You stop!
I just remember when I was a young man, I really wanted to dismantle that movie. Like, it really, really, it bothered me that like, because the whole moral of Forrest Gump seemed like, okay, you're not taking a real good look at what American culture is. You kind of caught me on a way more complex I don't know how I'm going to explain my way out of this one. I didn't like the way that the whole moral of Forrest Gump seemed to be just like, okay, if you just do what anybody tells you, starting with your mother, if you just do exactly what you're told when you're told, then everything's going to be all right for you. Like, no, it won't. It really, really won't. Bad things are going to happen to you. You won't get to fall in love with that girl because she's going to use you.
Jenny uses people.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Jenny had a rough go of it, man.
But she Jenny really wanted did. To be Bert.
I don't think she deserved as much criticism as Ben threw at her. But...
You didn't ask to get sick with AIDS. Yeah. Jenny had a rough life too. I'll give Jenny a little bit of credit, but you know, she may have used a mentally handicapped man. So
yes.
Wait a minute. What?
She used him, a mentally handicapped man. She used him a little
saying,
bit.
You're saying so Gump was mentally handicapped in that movie, huh?
Oh God.
That changes everything.
Greg, I have so much to explain to you.
Yeah, man. I remember, and God, I hope I didn't tell this. What's the John Can I Pet the Rabbits?
Of Mice and Men.
Yeah, Mice and Men. Oh. Yeah. Oh. John Steinbeck. I think I wrote a paper on that book in high school. And I'm like, again, I've told you guys this with music. Like sometimes I just don't see what's in front of my face. And I remember like writing a paper being like, I was like, I don't know, I'm an idiot, but I was like, I didn't think it was cool. Like, I don't want to call this guy retarded, basically. who am I to call this guy, mentally unstable or mentally handicapped or whatever. And again, back then the word retarded was not as, but anyways, I remember writing like sort of like falling short on it. I was like, and this guy, has some mental problems or, he's near retarded. And I got the paper back and my teacher had crossed it out and wrote in red pen, "Yes, Greg, he is retarded." That's a big part of the book. I'm like, yeah, I guess he was. Man, I just didn't feel like we needed to call it out, Why are we piling on the guy, man?
I would love to have been your teacher. I love how they handled that. Yes,
yeah,
Greg.
She was just like, yes, Greg, he is retarded. That's the point of the book. I'm like, yeah, I mean, I know. I just, why do we gotta say that?
You would own the internet for a day if you had a picture of that.
You're right, man. I gotta go see if I can. My mom probably saved that.
That's really cool. All right, what else we got, Ben? Because I know you were deep into Miami's whole sound machine in this episode.
I just got into the weeds with Gloria Estefan and the Cuban Revolution. Like, I was just amazed that the biggest Cuban pop star in the world also has such deep ties to the island's politics. I was amazed. I mean, that's like, I don't know. I can't think of another person to express, like finding out that Sinead O'Connor was in the IRA or something. Like, it's just insane. Like, how, wait a second, you are that closely tied
to
the things that happened on that island. It's amazing.
You know, the only thing, you pretty much hit every point on that. The only thing that I wanted to add was, I guess when he did come home and the American military was training him and, they did Bay of Pigs, basically they went off to train these guys for Bay of Pigs. Mm. And he wasn't allowed to tell his wife and Gloria where he was that whole time. Yep. They had no idea. And then they just see basically on TV, here's this thing. And they figured out, oh, he's doing that. And it didn't work,
Yeah, he's definitely part of that. And it didn't work for disastrous and stupid reasons. I mean, there's a lot, it's hard to, when you're reading about the Bay of Pigs, it's hard to separate fact from fiction. Like, I've read stories that they didn't understand the time change. And that's the reason why there's no way that's true,
man.
But you can read that on so many different websites. Like, oh yeah, it was supposed to be 10 o'clock Central Standard Time, but it turns out that that's noon New York time, or whatever the fuck. You're like, that can't be.
That's no. It could be. I've got idiot friends in LA that do not understand that, where they just call me, "What's up, brother? I'm sleeping, man."
Yeah, but hopefully your idiot friends in LA aren't trying to overthrow Fidel Castro. Yeah.
No, they're not that aspirational, actually.
No. All right, so is now a good time to see how Jeremy messes with Greg Warren on this week's
yes, it is.
Nobody's sure. More aware of my horrible music taste than Jeremy Essig, man. I guarantee he's gonna bring up when he was a young feature act, and we went on the road together, I think one time, or he was an MC. We went on the road to Little Rock, and you know, he was just a kid, and I was a little older, and you know, you're not gonna say anything. And I think I made him listen to like a Herb Alpert CD the whole way up there. And you know, Jeremy's like all about music and a musician and knows everything about music. I made him listen to the Herb Albert.
You're gonna
I stand
like
by
this,
Herb
then.
Albert. But...
You're gonna like this then, Greg.
Oh no.
All right, let's watch it.
Hey friends, welcome to another edition of 6 Degrees, where this week we're going to connect Gloria Estefan to Tommy Stinson. A suggestion from Greg Warren, a man with a musical experience, was when he drove me from St. Louis to Little Rock, Arkansas, for me to listen to Herb Alpert the entire time. The man whose musical tastes are so bad, I shot a pilot for a TV show based on a conversation Mike McCray and I had about just how bad they truly were. He's got an interesting musical path, and our first connection through the chairman of the board, Frank Sinatra. Riding a wave of boomer nostalgia in the early 90s, Sinatra released two albums of digitally created duets, the first album featuring Gloria Estefan and the second album featuring former Miami Sound Machine member John Cicada, as well as a track between Sinatra and Pretenders founder Chrissy Hynde. That band's only consistent member since their formation in 1978, Hynde has surrounded herself with many musicians over the years, including one night in 2018 with the rhythm section from Superchunk and the Bob Mould Band, drummer John Worster and bassist Jason Narduzzi. Narduzzi and Worster also make up two-thirds of the band's split single, whose newest album, Amplificado, features bass from Mike Mills, best known as one of the founders of REM, alongside guitarist Peter Buck, who played on The Replacements' I Will Dare, alongside bass from Tommy Stinson. So, Gloria Estefan to Frank Sinatra, to The Pretenders, to split single, to REM, to Tommy Stinson. Sorry, Greg.
I called it.
You called it.
Yeah. That was good. And Jeremy, I do know a little bit more about music, but he got me onto The Replacements, who I really, really
love. Good.
But I know he's a giant Replacements fan. He's also a giant Superchunk fan, I think. So
yeah.
Superchunk. I don't think I've heard that name in 15 years.
Superchunk.
As soon as I heard, what was their big hit?
I don't know. It was always one of those names that was just around me, but I never like latched onto it.
Yeah, I think they had one of those like wild like 90s like huge hits that you just couldn't get away from it. And I want to say it was in like all the Sandler movies and then disappeared completely. I'm going to have to look it up. I'm sorry if you're listening and you're screaming the name of the song into your headphones, but I just can't hear you.
Superchunk. Usually a song. Hyper Enough. Driveway to Driveway. Slack Motherfucker. Was it Slack Motherfucker?
I don't think it was Slack Motherfucker.
Okay. I didn't think about it, Greg, because you've already been a guest on the show and we've already asked you a guilty pleasure song, which you said all yours are guilty pleasures.
Yeah, man. I mean, there's nothing to be proud of, but I'll do a terrible one if...
Yeah.
Yeah, I like that theme from America's Greatest Hero.
Is that what you did last time?
Did I do that one last time?
That might have been what your guilty pleasure song was. What is the name of the song?
It's well, I know it goes, "Believe it or not,
I'm walking on it. Yeah.
I don't know if I do. I know that's got to be like one of the, even me, I'm like, man, I'm glad nobody knows I'm listening to this at the gym right now. But
I was going to say, like, how much of your musical tastes are influenced by like your days as like a high school wrestler and a college wrestler, where you're listening to like the pump up songs like as you're running 97 miles at 5 o'clock in the morning?
That was that thing though. That it's like wrestlers they only had like three albums. It was, and it was AC/DC and you know, and this Scorpions, that was a big one for us to cut weight to in college. Like we had it all timed up. Like I go in, we'd like, you can't do any of this stuff. It's illegal now, but we would like seal off these showers and turn the showers on and put on like sauna suits and put a bike in there and be like, all right, you ride in there for two songs on Scorpions Live, and then you go out and, you know, kind of gather yourself, then you go back in for another song, and it's like you could lose like 8 pounds to the Scorpions Live album.
Can I ask you an inside wrestling question?
What's that?
Why is that not allowed now? It's like, is it not allowed because it's not healthy and it puts the wrestler in danger?
Yeah.
Is it not allowed because like you can cut so much water weight and like you can get down to 140 and then be 168 the next day?
It's the former. It's it's, I think some kids died in the 90s, and I don't think it was because of all that, but I think it was that combined with there was some supplements that were going on. I think it was like the kids started taking creatine and they were dehydrating and a couple of kids died. So they basically no sauna suits. And then, you know, we would weigh in for a tournament. We would weigh in the night before, or for a dual match, just a match, it would be 5 hours before. So in those 5 hours, like you do, even if it's the 5 hour, you have a lot of time to rehydrate. And now they have like an hour. So tournaments and matches, you step on the scale, you're on the mat an hour later. So you can't completely do all that crazy stuff or you wouldn't be able to function.
Right.
But yeah, Ben's not that far off. Like, you know, I was wrestling 150 my junior year and I was probably walking around. The next day I was probably 160, you know, or when I was wrestling. So.
Holy moly. I mean, I just need to sometimes fit into a dress for an occasion. So tell me exactly again what I need to do.
No, you don't want to do this. You will not be
I do very... like Scorpions. I feel like I can do it.
I think so. Wrestlers... it was AC/DC and Scorpions and, you know, maybe a little bit of,
maybe some rap.
Aerosmith. There was not much, you know, one of Freddie introduced us to some rap, but, Aerosmith, the early stuff, which I liked. And then, man,
I
this is
rat, like, by the way.
Oh, rat. R-A-T-T. I thought you said rap. Okay. No. Yeah. There might've been a little, a rat.
Lay it down.
This was always funny to me. I don't know why I just thought of it, but one time in college, my friend Dave Canace, like, he had like a bunch of cassettes and like some girls were coming over or something. And one of them said, dance tunes on there or dance mix, you know, and it was Van Halen. It was just
California girls, maybe.
Yeah, it was just bad. That's what Dave thought. Girls like to dance too. Was
Hot for teacher. That's awesome. All right, man. Well, I think I don't want to let you go, but I think we're done with.
You guys, thanks so much, man. And I really enjoy listening to it. It's such a great podcast, man.
And thank you for being a Patreon member. Do you want to stick around for the drawing? That's what we have to do now.
Oh yeah, sure. Next. Yeah.
And for people listening, if you want to become a Patreon member, it's $5 a month. Just support the show, and then we put your name in this bucket. And once a month, we draw a name, and they get to choose a song we cover, like we just did. So for October, we have Ben's mom.
That's awesome. I can't wait to tune in on that one. Yep. Oh, this what Canadian it's gonna be Anne Murray, obviously.
No, it's not gonna be Anne Murray. It'll be Rod Stewart, it'll be Super Tramp. Might get some Super Tramp, could get some Glass Tiger.
What was their hit?
Glass Tiger. They had a couple of hits, didn't they?
They had one big hit.
Yeah.
I tried to make a joke about one time and nobody got it.
No one got it. Ben's mom got it.
Island Sun was a big thing. Or no, this Island Earth. I think that was their big hit. I could be wrong about that. They probably have a much bigger one than I can remember.
They do. It's a giant one.
Don't forget me. Yeah.
Don't forget me.
Oh, that's what it
is. Is that the one?
Yeah.
Absolutely, that is the hit that we could not remember.
Yeah, okay. That's one of many songs from the late 80s where Brian Adams just chimes in for one disembodied headline.
All right. Or, well,
it could be Bryan Adams too. Hopefully she'll pick Bryan Adams and we can talk about Bryan Adams and Princess Diana.
Oh man. I hope so.
Yeah.
Be good.
Yeah.
but Bryan Adams, guys, another a guy that was played a lot in St. Louis in his before he was big.
Oh, really?
He used to come hang out at the radio station in St. Louis. Yeah.
Oh, wow. Yeah. Ben, would your mom come on the show? I'm sure the listeners would love that.
She would definitely come on. We could totally get patched in.
Oh, this is great, man. This is awesome.
Maybe we'll do it. Let's ask her. And then maybe like if it's all right with you, maybe the three of us could do it in studio, Diane.
Yeah, that'd be great.
Just give it a shot. Let's see what she says.
All right. Well, we have to say goodbye to Greg now. It makes me sad.
Bye, guys.
Always good to see you.
Thanks so much, man. Yeah, thanks so much. Great job.
All right.
Can't wait to hear the one with Ben's mom.
Okay. Right. Bye, see Greg.
Ya. Thanks, Greg.
I'm going to remove.
Don't remove. I'm going to call my mama.
I'm so excited. All right. Before we leave, I want to say, okay, so next week, we aren't discussing a song. We are not discussing a band or a particular artist. We are discussing what I consider to be the mecca of 80s new wave music. You've heard us talk about this place so many times on the podcast. Numbers is Houston's, it's not even just Houston's, the oldest. It's been around for 43 years. It is a dance club and I love it so much. And our guest loves it even more than I do, so much that he made a documentary about it. Here's the poster. Is it backwards? Are you reading it backwards? Dang it.
No, it's perfect.
Okay, good. So next week we will be joined by Marcus Pontello, and I hope I'm saying it right. He's a fashion designer and creator / director of Friday I'm in Love, a documentary film about the oldest alternative club in the entire United States. I don't even know how I want to structure the episode yet. Like I want to talk about the film, which I've seen and it's perfect. But I also want to talk about the music of Numbers and like the whole vibe and the impact that it's had on so many generations. Like I said, the club is as old as I am. So there's people who enjoyed it in the 80s and then there's my generation. And then Marcus, I think is like 10 years younger than me. So there's a lot to discuss here and I'm really, really excited about this episode.
It's going to be a fun episode.
Yeah. And I'm excited about your mom coming up. This is going to be great. All right.
Go call right from the mountains of Cuba to the beaches of Miami. I believe we have Vogue.
One, two, three.
Rock the Cash Bar is produced by Diane Gallagher. Music by Chuck Savage and Eddie Hawkins. Special thank you to Jeremy Essig for 6 Degrees of Tommy Stinson and to Sara Wessling for the Guilty Pleasures vocals. Our website is rockthecashbarpodcast.com, and there you can find links to our Spotify playlist and to our Patreon. Thank you for tuning in, and we will see you next week.